All right, John, it's noon. There you go. How are you, everybody? I am back broadcasting from Orlando, and this is Chris French, and I am Director of Development at CPF, and right above me is...
My name is John Haber. I am the Field Services Director, and today's program, it will be an hour in length. Chris and I will go over some basics to get us going, and then we'll jump right into the recording. Just so you know, today's first portion of the program will be 30 minutes in length. It's a pre-recorded session with Wayne Donaldson on plastic architecture. And then we'll move over to the Airstream session, which will be followed by a Q&A. And we encourage all of you to ask those questions early and often. So please do use the Q&A box in Zoom. And if you're on Facebook, YouTube, or any of the other platforms, you can ask those questions there as well, and we'll try to monitor those and get them addressed at the end of the program. If you'd like to ask your question in person, you can always raise your hand and we'll see if we can enable your voice for that. But let us jump right in. Chris, do you have anything else?
John, I always have something else, and I'm so glad you asked me. First, I want to say hi to my new friend in Atlanta, Nelson. I see him in the chat. Part one of a three-part program, and we have the next one is when, John? Next week?
Next one is next Thursday at 12 noon, so we'd love to see you there. It'll be a quick journey through some roadside architecture across the country.
Right, very special. And then there's also a part three. Just check our website, californiapreservation.org, to see all of our upcoming programs. All right, and if you post any comments in the chat, you might find your friends in the chat box. So I'm going to be in the chat box, John. So go ahead and roll the video.
Okay, great.
All right, well, thanks for having me again as a speaker. I think you're going to find this a rather interesting subject matter, and I'm glad to be part of it. Next. The moving of structures, especially for shelters, has been around for a long, long time. The Plains Indians of the Sioux and Cheyenne, the Crow, and the Blackfoot have used what's referred to as the teepee one. Comfortable, roomy, it's only 400 pounds, and as they move it, two-thirds of the weight is dragged on the ground. Next. The Bedouin tent is one of the earliest forms of shelters associated with a lot of the nomadic tribes. And this type of tent can also be divided into various rooms and normally found with a lot of the tribes of ancient Sinai and Mesopotamia. But instead of goat's hair or sackcloth that the tents were made of, they're now using the most advanced plastic fabrics and that can stretch. And these go back 6,000 years BCE. Next. Ron Heron of Archigram came up with this concept in 1961 of the walking city. It's sort of a a United Nations city taken to the extreme. And the whole idea is that whole families could live in these, move across. You would go ahead and live off the land for a while and then leave so it could recover itself and move around. So the concepts have been around for some time. Next. Buckminster Fuller, though, really brought everything to focus during his time, mostly in the early 50s and 60s. Besides appearing on the cover of Time magazine with a lot of the inventions, the geodesic dome that he basically patented in 1951 was unique. He came to talk to us at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo before his death. And it was interesting because one of the first questions he said, next, was how much does your building weigh? And what is the embodied energy that it took to make those pieces? And how do you transport it? A lot of questions that we were not even thinking of during the time, even though we were dealing with a lot of mid-century modern architecture. The little inset to the left there is myself all the way to the left, helping carry in one of Fuller's domes at Cal Poly. We had to move it out to the canyon, which was an experimental thing. It was interesting that in the late 1960s, when he was doing this, is that mobile homes accounted for 20% of the housing units. Next. Of course, the classic film, The Graduate, with Dustin Hoffman as Ben and Anne Bancroft as Mrs. Robinson, 1967. If you haven't seen this, you must see it. It's ranked as the 17th greatest American film of all. And let's go ahead and we'll play this. And I think you'll see where we're going.
Okay, I just forgot to make sure I optimized for video before we... Okay, do you see it now?
Yeah.
Okay.
What are you going to do now?
I was going to go upstairs for a minute.
Oh, I meant with your future.
Your life.
Well, that's a little hard to say.
Ben.
Excuse me. Mr. McGuire.
Ben.
Mr. McGuire.
Come with me for a minute. I want to talk to you. Excuse us, Joanne.
Of course.
Thank you.
It's
just wonderful.
I look at him and I can't believe it. I just
want to say one word to you. Just one word.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening?
Yes, I am.
Plastics.
Exactly. How do you mean?
There's a great future in plastics. Think about it. Will you think about it?
Yes, I will.
I've said. That's a deal.
Next. All right, so what's so unique about plastics compared to all the other materials that we normally use? Well, first of all, they're tailor-made molecules. The polymers you can formulate and modify to meet several different specific requirements, which is unique to any other types of materials that we have. Next. This is a polyethylene molecule compared to human DNA down below. Basically, we have the same footprints together and a lot. So if you wish, you can turn yourself into a piece of plastic when you pass away. Next. Plastic Man came out about the same time in December of 1966. And it was the first issue of Plastic Man as an action hero. Never took off with the kids. They didn't think much of him as an action hero, maybe because the plastics were too difficult to understand. But you can see he can stretch, he can snap. It just never seemed to go anywhere. Next. Okay, crash course right here. There's two major types of plastics. Thermoplastics, which are like nylon, polyethylene, polypropylene, styrene, those types. And you can see from this earlier ad from DuPont. Next. You can see from this earlier ad from DuPont with this best things in life come in cellophane with this poor baby wrapped up. Next. We also had some adventures that we had created. We were teaching a class in plastics, Albert Spidell and myself, back in 1970, First Earth Day. So these guys called themselves Earth Force, and these were inflatable structures. Next. And it was fun for the students. They can actually build something and put them up and get inside. And we lasted pretty much about 5 months on campus before they got a little bit vandalized. Next. So plastics, besides being with the Apollo 11 space technology that you see on the left, also with my granddaughter Scarlett and her plastic swimwear, we tend to be basically wearing a lot of these and dealing with them, including a lot of the resins and stuff. So we're dealing with plastics around them. And I don't mean the bad plastics, the ones that get out in the ocean and stuff. That's a management problem as well as a manufacturing thing. We're talking about the ones that will really help our lives. Next. The next class, which we'll find in buildings, are called thermal sets, epoxies, polyester resins, urethanes with the foams, some of the stuff that we use for skylights and things like that. Next. The Monsanto House of the Future in 1958, even though it was designed at MIT and a lot of the research work and parts were made there. Basically, it found its way, of course, to Disneyland and Tomorrowland. And it was an incredible emphasis on using plastics in the building industry. Before this time, it was generally as a substitute material, but with the success of a lot of prefab building products, especially like Monsanto, they became more adapted to a lot of the large firms like TRW, Owens Corning, Bird Air, and started to use them to meet the growing need for housing. Next. It was one of the first applications of fiber reinforced plastic. It was cantilevered from a concrete foundation and steel beams and a monolithic floor and wall system. As you can see, the pieces being put together. So it could basically be transferred, made somewhere else, and then put together on the site. It's interesting, it was demolished in 1972. When I was 8 years old, I wanted to be an architect, and it was 16 during opening day when I first saw it. And everybody still remembers it. Next. And then a lot of movable, lightweight structures began cropping up all over. Battersea College of Technology in 1962 in London, all plastic spiral vault. Next, 1963 in Osaka, Japan, the Suzuki cabin using all fiberglass reinforcement and a new material called styrol sponge, which is polystyrene foam for insulation, which is pretty much like our cups that we have nowadays. Weighs about 400 pounds, about the weight of a Sioux teepee. Next. I had a good friend that I went to school with, Cal Poly, graduated in 67 with Elbert. He went on and I went on, and then all of a sudden he wanted to develop a thing that he had always dreamed about called polypods. Poly meaning polymer, and of course pods meaning pods. So when I was overseas studying at the University of Strathclyde, he was in at University of Mellon, or Mellon University in Pittsburgh. And so next, so we wanted to develop these from an earlier model he had made. So we're fortunate enough to find a person to invest. We basically next built this out at his branch out in Confluence, Pennsylvania, and did a mock-up the first year. You see the formwork in the background. And it was interesting. We're using farm labor to help us. Not a whole bunch of high technology stuff going on here. Basically put the components together. I did all the structural analysis for it. Next. And then we did some campaigning to do some marketing if we could get some investors interested. This happens to be Mary back in 1970 with her daughter. So we staged these shots and put them together as a sales brochure. Next. Developer got interesting. We worked with a group called MHI to really do an in-house production of these, and then set out selling them. Not too many were built. And unfortunately, over the years during this time, especially with the embargo coming in, the oil embargo in the early 1970s really took the price of plastic and took it out of sight. And everything that was being made out of plastics, including a lot of travel trailers and everything else, went back to aluminum stud and the standard stuff that you still see nowadays. So next. So during a National Trust Conference back in Pittsburgh, Albert basically said, well, see if you can find some of my structures around. And sure enough, I only found one. All the rest of them were unfortunately gone. And it was initially as a bank and then turned into a commissioner's office. Next. And this kind of gives you a little bit of the scale that they were. They kind of looked like, and Albert always joked about it, like a TV set that you're looking at. But you can join them together. And as you saw from the model, then go ahead and extend on them. Next. So the interiors were light and airy. You could have larger windows and stuff like that. Things seemed to work out pretty well. And then lo and behold, I found that he was going to demolish it. And I said, oh my God. So I contacted Albert and I said, Albert, they're going to demolish it. What do you want to do? So went back and basically we brought out some units next. And Albert wanted to have them at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo where he was teaching. And we had an experimental area out there called the Canyon where a lot of people came and built these experimental structures, and that's where he wanted to put it. But over the years, they just sat, they started to tilt over next. They became vandalized, glass was broken, and you can see part of the deterioration on the inside, some mold setting in. Next. Still had some of the interiors that were in halfway decent shape, so I told Albert, we really got to get them out of there. The risk manager was going to basically, from the college, take them out and throw them away if we didn't. So again, next one. We loaded it aboard a truck. And the nice thing is that the initial design that we came in with, that we decided to do, is that we could carry three or four of these on a flatbed as a wide load on any highway. So that made a lot of sense in doing that. We also made them so they could fit into a container if necessary. So that was one reason why the size came below. So the next item next was basically to transport them. So here's a little short movie on how this truck is moving up the highway carrying the polypods. There should be a little bit of sound with this, but that's okay if there's not. That's fine. So you can see, even going up the road is pretty nice with the oversized load. It's not considered a wide load, it's called an overload, so he can basically drive up without a vehicle going ahead or following behind. We're following behind, of course. Next. So then we then unloaded them in a place in Tascadero, and a short little video showing how these are easily come off the trucks and when we set them down. The nice thing about this, go ahead and play the video. The nice thing about this, that's okay, go ahead. It works really well, and they snap together using a gigantic aluminum ring that comes in, and it's kind of like a vice grip, and you set it and push it down and snap it together. Next. So here we are, a couple old dudes. Hopefully we'll get this thing back up and restored. Next. Forbidden Planet. This is a short take from the movie on Forbidden Planet. And 1956 American science fiction video, which I thought was rather curious, dropping science in there. It was unique because it set two parameters. One is it kind of set the background music for most of the great science fiction films in the 1950s. It also set the form of what everybody considered to be a flying saucer. And it was one of the first that was set on an interstellar space on a different planet, far away from Earth. And it was also the birth of Robbie the Robot. Next. Also, what's rather unique in this is that you'll see the stairs come down from the belly, which is a fairly traditional way now that most spaceships work. Next. So in 1967, Matty Sirin came up with the concept to do the Futuro House, basically an all plastic structural house that would support itself sitting on a simple egg thing. Next. The concept was to make it into pie shapes. So the pie shapes could be bolted together in one day or taken apart and moved on transport. So these fiber reinforced plastic shells, as you can see, came with two windows each and then the bottom. And they sat sort of in this ring. And this was the Futuro model. Next. And the Futuro model was a little bit different than the one that was built in the United States. One reason was, is that it only had 300 square feet. As you can see where the ring is down at the bottom, that's where the floor is on this capsule. So when you walk into it, you're actually standing and looking through the windows. So it has three banks of windows, and the Futuro that was built back in Philadelphia under license only came with two windows that we'll see later. Next. And the nice thing is that the interior was all built in with the plastics. This one is the number one, and it's now in the Central Museum in the Netherlands being completely restored. Next. Everything was plastic built in, including the kitchen, and these apart from the sales brochures. Next. It was also meant as part of the advertisement is to leave your food in the refrigerator. We'll move it for you and you can have dinner that night. So it came up with not only hotels, but basically stations that you could go and get plugged in. Next. However, due to its shape, it's hard to join two together or put one on top of the other. So the folks that wanted to have them, like this one bank, decided to have two and then provide a connection. Next. Back in the United States, 1970 issue of Playboy magazine really promoted the use of the Futuro. Next. It also advertised it could easily be removed by a sky crane, like this Sikorsky sky crane here, taken to your place and set down. Unfortunately, during this time, we're still in the Vietnam War. There wasn't too many helicopters around that we could use by. Next. However, it was an instant hit. I don't know how much you can see of the floor plan there, but it basically had its own bedroom, bathroom, kitchen, and dining area that flowed into the living room. And quite spacious, being 26 feet across and 13 feet high. It was called an ellipsoid, containing a lot of interior space. And as you can see, what was a major difference here is the legs. Basically, the ring is embedded into the body of it. And also, it only comes in four shell structures. We'll go through that a little bit more. It only came in two halves on the top and two halves on the bottom. Next. So Stan Grau in San Diego ordered one from Philadelphia, and it was delivered out to him. He tried to sell it. He didn't sell one of them. People didn't like the round windows, so he designed his own Grau house, as he called it. With square windows and operable windows and all that. But eventually it found its way, because Stan was at the design center in San Diego. Next. It found its way into the parking lot and sat there for years. Somebody painted it with a green latex paint, which is really great in the long run because it helped preserve part of it. They tried to demolish it. I used to put it on the tour when I was given tours of, of Lewis Gale buildings up in North Park and stuff, and we'd drop by and see it. I had come to know it quite well and was studying it quite well as all of that. Next. So we decided to go ahead and I wanted to buy it, and I finally got it for $15,000. He actually put it on eBay after he did a little bit of this surfing the web himself. So we took it out to the boatyard, moved it as a boat first time, of course, and put out the boatyard and then refinished the exterior. It had sat in the open for so long that a lot of the plastics were completely broken and dissolved. We had about a 5-foot hole in the top of it that we had to completely reform out of fiberglass and put everything back together. Next. Parts of the joints were coming loose, so we had to get in and install new stainless steel bolts. And then, but we did find, at least on the bottom portion of the shell, the top gel coat had all been removed, but the bottom point had, again, the yellow gel coat on the bottom. And I sent that to Dr. Susan Buck of Paint Chips, and she came up with a great match. And then we decided to go ahead and restore it using a very elastomeric boat paint. Next. Most of the steel was completely gone on it. I don't even know how it was holding up. When we took the bolt out, there was only about a 16th of an inch of it left. So I'm not sure how all that worked. And yet we picked them up by the legs, but somehow it all magically worked for us. So after we restored it, then we had to move it. Next. I was looking for a place that was sympathetic to the original design that Saradin had. And he was up in the mountains next to a lake, although it wasn't popular for him. They didn't like it. It wasn't a mountain cabin. The neighbors threatened to burn it down at one time. But anyway, we finished it and then decided to move it as one piece. And here is Interstate 15 closing three lanes. Next. We also had to move it up the mountain roads. And as most of you know, Caltrans is only 11 foot wide from the outer stripe to the center. So you only had 22 feet to play with. And again, it's 26 by 13. And we kept the legs on. So we sat it down low. And yes, we had to remove some stuff to get it up there. Next. It was the middle of the night when we finally got it up on the hill. We're supposed to have the movers up there with the crane guy. We got it up there at 3 o'clock. They're supposed to crane it into place. They refused to come, but with a little coaching, they finally came. Not really happy campers, but they came. And we basically put it up there. It was a 50 foot boom, quite a long reach to get up on this great site that you'll see later. Next. This is a real short video. It shows that some people were really watching what they're doing. It was great that my job foreman up there, Jim Kane, realized that we're gonna put the door over a 20 foot drop. And so we had to rotate it to make sure that we were back on the upper portion.
You want 15 feet.
Like he's done this before.
He's an architect.
I mean the crane guy.
Oh, that
I mean,
guy? Oh, that like-
I thought that was cute. Next. So we finally got it up. Now, the interior was still left to be restored. So Lori and I set out to restore it over about an 8-year period. Next. The interior had traditional popcorn ceiling with asbestos. Most of it had come down. We did remove it, but we restored it back. You'll see it later. However, we were blessed that all the features and everything else, the stoves and things were still intact inside the unit. Not in the greatest condition, but still in pretty doggone good condition. Next. A lot of the interior was still having some mildew problems and stuff. So we ended up scraping everything down, cleaning everything up and repatching it and getting it back together. Next. And then we got into really difficult code elements. One was the door. The Riverside Building Department, County of Riverside Building Department said, no, it's not a door. And this guy was great for surfing the web as well. Next. He says, this is what we need. We need to put a little doghouse on the outside. You take that door and lower it down and bolt it to the rocks. And we'll go. And I said, no, we can't do that. It would be horrible, yada, yada, yada. I said, why don't you come on up and try the door? See if it works for you. Go back one. And he basically found it's only 35 pounds counterweighted with a large counterbalance spring. And he says, great, no problem. Okay, let's go two forward. The other problem were the windows. They were missing. I didn't know what the curvature of the windows were on it. However, we found a great network of many, many people. You know, it takes a village to restore one of these. One of my friends in New Zealand basically took his window out of his Futuro and sent it to me. I had to come up with a mechanism, so I decided to look at how automobile glass is put in. And so we had these blown at Planet Plastics. And it was neat because the guy says, no, we have to blow these. We're not going to form them or a mold like we do acrylic skylights and stuff because they'll warp and you'll have distortion. So he came up with a concept. We trap it in a piece of acrylic. We heat it. blow it up to a certain, right to the dimension that we have, which is about 2.5 inches in the curvature to the top, and cools it down and it sets, puts it in the computer and makes them all exactly the same. Next. So the windows went in great. The only problem is they're all fixed. So the building inspector says, nope, in the bedroom, the window's gotta come out. So I came up and I said, well, we can't really do that, da, 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 da. And he says, well, here, I have a solution. Next. Again, he went online and I said, oh my God. I said, we can't do that. So I came up with a concept of a zip gasket within it, because we fixed it exactly like an automobile window would, and basically took care of it that way. You just pull on the ring, push the window out, and he's gone. Next. Had problems with fire during the Cedar fire in 2006. We're still going through the process. We didn't get our building permit. They said that the fire truck had to get within 50 feet. There's no way we could do that at the site. So we ended up sprinkling the building. It's a good solution. Next. We also had problems of snow loads, making sure that it would contain itself. It will carry 5 times the amount of snow that could fall in the area without any deformation. Next. We're also looking at seismic. They're a little bit concerned about the legs. So Thomas Tomasetti, we're working with the structural engineers from them. They went ahead and did the full calcs. I helped them on a lot of the shell structure myself in terms of the calculations, and found out that it's really great. I was actually in there with the lander's quake and could feel it shaking, but everything went through. You can now see the parts. You can see the ring that would divide it in half, and then a vertical ring going down that would divide it into parts. And again, the reason why we had to move it is because they basically went ahead and fixed everything. So I'm gonna show you a whole bunch of next interiors next. So we had a lot of fun, Lori and I, restoring it. The doors are curved to match the curved panels in there. Range and everything are great. We put in air conditioning. The units under stair is underneath. The compressor's out in a shed, so you can't hear it. That center console was an original piece of furniture that was built. We decided not to put back the fireplace in the center because of all the fire problems up at Idlewild. So we basically found this wonderful lamp and put a skylight in the opening instead of putting it back. Next. Over the years, guests have brought little robots up there that you can see. We kept all the plastic laminate. Yeah, it has a few scars and this and sort of stuff, but I wanted to keep as much as possible. It's built like a trailer, not in very good condition, certainly not an Airstream, but we decided to keep everything. The drawers are all plastic. Next. The table was original. We bought the chairs, the little console there to the coffee table to the right's original. Next. And it's a wonderful place to gather. Again, we put back the asbestos sedum with some gold flakes. No asbestos though, just the popcorn. Next. The bathroom, everything seemed to work out well in the bathroom. The nice thing is that when it did go to the design center, it just stayed like that forever and ever. They didn't use it for an office. So we were real fortunate, including having the overhead sliding counters and stuff like that. So we were real happy with it. Next. We're very pleased. This is a Paul Clausal photos, one of the great photographers, and we're just real happy with it and real pleased, but it was a real hassle. I think in hindsight, the concept of moving this by helicopter, by the way, I did contact Aris and Crane. We couldn't move it. We'd have to stop any state or international highway and stop the traffic as it goes over the top. So that was certainly out. But I think it still fulfilled the dreams of having it moved, and also I was so happy to have it now as a California historical landmark, and it's also on the national register at the state level of significance. So we're real happy with it. Thank you all.
Hey, John, that was a pretty good video.
Yes.
Hearing that backstory, that was
nice.
Great.
There were some comments in the chat that one in Joshua Tree is available, and sometimes the Wayne and Laurie Donaldson Futuro is available, and often at our annual auction, which we encourage people to check out in December. So now we're going to move over to Brad Cornelius, and he's going to talk about his work with his Airstream, and I'm sure many other interesting Airstream factoids. So we're going to turn it straight over to you, Brad, and at the end we're going to have a brief Q&A, and we'll have a special guest at the Q&A as well. So look forward to that.
Terrific. Well, thank you so much. I'm Brad. I'm an artist and a illustrator. I'm an art director, and I'm someone who has studied and appreciated great design for as long as I can remember. Today, we're going to talk about a very specific area of great design, and that's the classic travel trailers that we all know and love. I want to first start by thanking the California Preservation Foundation for inviting me to speak today. I have so much admiration for everyone who does this kind of work. Striving to preserve and find new uses for historic buildings is something that is just endlessly fascinating to me. Each case presents a unique opportunity and a set of challenges. And so it's fun to watch any of these projects go through and become a successful way to keep it in our society. There's also a lot of similarities between historic architecture preservation as well as vintage trailer preservation. And that's that each one is a unique situation, and each one allows the owner to decide the ratio of new and old. How many things are you going to restore back to the way it was originally? And what are you going to take into the 21st century to make it applicable to today's needs? So I think you'll find a lot of overlap. And as we move forward, I think that that'll be a fun thing to watch for. In both cases, we're faced with an object that most people consider beyond its usefulness, and it takes a special quality to look beyond those superficial blemishes and decay and identify what makes it special and how to celebrate it. So let's get started here with our slides. Get going here. This is our trailer on a recent trip up the coast. And what I'm going to start with actually is the passion that I have for architecture and history and exploration. Any chance that I get, I will hop a fence, I will peek through broken windows, and I will find that old factory, that abandoned motel, or that forgotten farm. And I'll take pictures, I'll study its history online when I get home, I'll look at Google Earth and see if I can figure out, you know, where that railroad went or where that dead-end road used to lead. Thankfully, my wife Melissa is an interior designer, and she shares a lot of these interests for things that have otherwise outlived their usefulness. And for more than 25 years, we've restored old hand tools, wooden canoes, cast iron printing presses. We've even adopted 4 X-racing greyhounds, which were past their usefulness at the track. These are some of the photos I've taken along our explorations. So in our 20s, we were, our late 20s, we were married. We were in love with the great outdoors. We would take trips out to Yosemite and camp in the desert. Mostly tent-based, and it's no big surprise that when we started seeing images of vintage trailers, we saw this incredible way to overlap the nostalgia and history of trailers with your love for being outdoors and exploring the world. It adds a layer of fun to every trip. And the moment that you attach one of these big shiny things to your bumper and pull out of the driveway, you're showing the world who you are. You're showing everyone what's important to you. You're showing that you appreciate craftsmanship and a desire to be unique and a willingness to not take yourself too seriously. Nearly all these trailers were considered to have lost their usefulness. And yet when we bring them back to life, they're not only as good as new, but they're a whole new way to make people smile and a way to make friends. This hobby also has become inextricably connected to my career as an artist. I made connections through our trailer ownership with the publisher of Airstream Life magazine, where I've been on the board of directors as the art director since 2005. There's one of my early illustrations showing I can do kind of logo-based stuff as well as I'm inspired to make some fun images as well. I've also looked at the fine art element of this and done a series of posters. These are early sketches and a couple of the ones that made it to the final version. So on that note, I think we can start jumping into this thing. And we're going to skip past the RVs of the 1930s and 40s. That's an awfully early time for this industry. And a lot of the trailers were made of masonite. There were canvas roofs, and a whole lot of them did not survive. But once we get to the end of World War II, everything is starting to change. America is full of enthusiasm and optimism. The camping and recreational travel during the war had come to a complete halt. And Americans were, of course, rationing everything from food and gas to the raw materials themselves that built these trailers, aluminum and steel. So now there's this huge workforce as the soldiers return home. And within the first 2 to 3 years after the war, you have 150 trailer companies being founded. Building every size and shape of trailer. There's an incredible amount of imagination and money going into this generation of RVs at this point, and from 46 to, well into the 1960s, of course. And the vast majority of the projects that we see being restored today are from this era. These are the ones that everybody wants. There's a couple of campgrounds from those early days. And of course, it's just oozing with the nostalgia and the history that we love to look back on fondly. And now let's go over a couple of specific examples of the brands that were kind of at the top of the heap at the time. You had Spartan, which was owned by J. Paul Getty, who was building aircraft during World War II. And of course, when the war ended, he had these incredible factories in Tulsa and an incredible workforce of craftspeople. And they were able to pivot, as we say in pandemic times, and start working on trailers. And they made some unbelievable contributions to the world of camping and RVs. We'll go through some of these exterior and interior shots of some of these. Here's a glider from 46, 47. And this one actually was restored by a friend of mine up in Chico, California. His company is Vintage Trailer Coach Restoration. And he just did an incredible job with this one. Bulls Arrow is another one, a brand that survived well into the 70s when a lot of these others had faltered and gone away. And of course, Airstream. We all love Airstream, and they're still around today. They're sort of the 900-pound gorilla, but they were just another manufacturer in the early days, along with everybody else. We're going to get into these canned hams now, which are very popular today for restoration projects because they're lightweight. They're fairly straightforward to restore. Their construction method was, in most cases, a wood frame with aluminum skin over the top of it. And they make wonderfully lightweight, easy to tow trailers that people can enjoy with their families today. All different, again, all different lengths, all different options inside, different layouts. Here's the Holiday House, which was designed by the Harry and David Fruit Company, of all people. They had all of their agricultural workers with nothing to do, sitting on their hands every winter. And so they started building trailers as well. Outside of these traditional trailers that hook up to your bumpers, you've got the teardrop trailers, which were really nothing more than a bed and a kitchenette in the back in that trunk area. And then on the other end, you had two-story, 40 and almost 50-foot long trailers that could hold a family of four as a full-time residence. Really incredible stuff, pushing the boundaries of what could fit on the highways of the 50s and 60s. And of course, the beloved truck campers. They've always been kind of the looked down upon a little bit, I think, by other RVers, but they're absolutely charming and they're really coming into their own. They have a versatility and they were literally a way to put a tiny apartment in the back of your truck. What more could you ask for? So generally speaking, the restoration of these things started to become a big thing in the late 90s and early 2000s. The internet was allowing people to find a much wider audience when selling their trailer in their barn. And now you had people from all over the country that were interested in participating. In 2004 or five, Ralph Lauren renovated four Airstreams in different themes and he auctioned them off for $150,000 a piece. So you had a new level of popularity that people had previously associated with kind of rundown trailer parks. And now they were kind of the darling. They were the belle of the ball. They were chic, for better or worse. Message boards were being devoted to specific brands as well. And that created opportunities for people to restore these things that really hadn't had a network of being able to do this type of thing in the past. There's never been a better time to be part of this community. And in fact, there's companies that started coming about 15, 20 years ago that make the parts that have gone out of production over the years. So you can get rubber window gaskets and the little clearance marker plastic lenses and basically anything you need, reproduction door handles and lights and sconces for the inside and rain gutters for the outside. Just an endless amount of detail. As much as you want to be an obsessive enthusiast, you go for it because there's a way to find pretty much anything you want or to repair whatever you can find from this era. And people are saving every little scrap, every bit of hardware. It's pretty fun. This is our first trailer. We got it in 2003. We lived in Chicago. We drove, snowstorm out through the Bitterroots and the Cascades to Seattle. We brought it home and there it sat for a couple of years. We realized we were in way over our heads. I didn't have the skills or the time to learn how to fix this thing up. And it was in pretty awful shape. We got as far as gutting it, as many people do. And if you look on Craigslist or Facebook Marketplace, you'll often find half gutted trailers that were abandoned because people get in over their heads. So we wound up selling this one. There I am demoing it. Here's our second trailer. This is a Goldilocks situation. If that first one was too big of a project, this one was too small of a project. It's the same size and year and layout as the first trailer, but this one on the inside was perfect. It was like a time capsule. It had been pulled into a barn in Ohio and just never touched. The oven had never been used. The fridge works, everything was great. And yeah, maybe the wood needed a little bit of refreshing, but we just kept resisting the urge to monkey with it because it was in such great shape. So we wound up selling this one as well. We did polish it. We did take it out to the West Coast a few times, having some fun cross-country trips, and enjoyed ourselves immensely. And we handed it off to the next owner. Now we get to our current trailer. And this is actually the trailer that we own. In the process of restoration, I was able to locate the original family. They're now down in Florida. All the kids had grown up. They had had bunk beds inside this thing. They had gone on rallies from Michigan to Florida and back every year. And they just loved this thing. So they were incredibly excited to hear that it was going to be back on the road and that it would have a new life with us. And this is how we found it. It was empty inside, and that gave us, you know, going back to what I was first saying about the difference between an old trailer and a new one is that when it's old and when it's empty, you can really reimagine what you want this thing to be. You can look at the layout and say, this is what we want to change, and this is what would fit our lifestyle better, or we have kids, or we have big dogs, or whatever the case may be. And in our situation, of course, we had been camping in that smaller trailer where we had to turn the sofa into a bed every night and back into a sofa the next morning. And here comes this clean slate that lets us kind of reimagine everything we wanted to do. And we could immediately see it for what it was going to become. We knew where the bed would go, tucked in the back, and the bathroom would largely stay in the same area where you see it here. And with a kitchen running down that long side of windows. And the first step was to take it to a restoration shop because I knew that it would be faster and more efficient for us to have that spongy subfloor replaced by some professionals. So they used this stuff called MDO, medium density overlay. It's a kind of like a plywood, but it's used for billboards. It's used for the decks of pontoon boats. And it's impregnated with resin and has a vinyl face on the front and back, and it's just fantastic. So that gave us a true clean slate to work with. Let's talk a little more generally real quick about the process and some of the things you've got to think of if you're interested in getting involved in this. And I would say the first thing is to be really honest with yourself and ask questions like, how much of the work are you willing to do? Are you capable of, or interested in learning new skills and becoming competent with new tools? Are you willing to contract out the stuff that you can't do or don't want to do? And most importantly, do you have the time that it takes while this is being restored for the next year or two, potentially longer? Or are you going to become antsy and actually start feeling a little betrayed by this thing that's preventing you from going out and making those memories now while your kids are young or while you're young and healthy yourself? You don't want that to turn into resentment is what I'm saying. So you want to pick the right project. And in that vein, there's just every possibility to choose from. These things are now 50, 60, 70 years old, and you can find some that are in pretty good original shape. You'll pay more for them, but you'll get to use them sooner. Making a plan is the next major important thing. And it's really important and critical to plan out your mechanicals. Where are they going to be located? The wires inside the wall, your water tanks, if they're below the floor in the middle of the sections of subframe, where are those going to be accessible from? Having my wife being a space planner for a job is, I can't reiterate how important that was to us because it gave us the ability to sort of look into the future and say, the cabinetry is going to be determined by the size of the appliances and the location of those appliances is going to be determined by where the ports are for the city water or the electricity coming in from the outside. So the more organized and informed during these planning stages, the less frustrated you'll be later on. This is just an example, a partial example of 1 year of Airstreams. As you're looking through old trailer ads for potential projects, there's every different sort of layout. And like I said, this is just half of the options for 1 year of just Airstream. And as I said, there were many, many companies operating at that time. So here's some of our layout images. We've got our interior DC 12 volt system there on the left, and over on the right, you've got your 120 volt house style outlets. and all of the appliances that run off of each of those is marked in each situation. There at the bottom of each side, you can see the oven has an outlet that requires 110 hidden in that area, but the oven itself requires a 12 volt system. And you've got your batteries down there under the sofa on the far lower left. And in the lower right, you can see the inverter, which is turning that battery power back into 120 volt power when you are off grid. You want to be able to go and use a hairdryer or a coffee maker in the middle of the woods. This is how you do it. All those systems are being planned early on. Here's the wiring just inside the walls. And this is only for the seven-way plug that goes from your tow vehicle to the trailer. So there's a lot of thought that's going into this because you want your brake lights to work and your turn signals. And you want the, of course, the electric brakes hooked up to the axle back there so that the trailer isn't pushing you every time you arrive at an intersection. And it's charging the batteries while you drive. We even made another layout for the amount of wood we were going to need based on the cabinetry. And that allowed us to shop for thin veneer plywood, which would be placed over all of the skeletons that sort of make up the structure of the inside of the trailer itself. This is also a great time to figure out your appliances. Go ahead and get what you're going to use at this point, because as you can see there on the left, they're a tight fit and they need to slide into a specific cabinet width. That refrigerator and freezer over on the right is out of the marine environment. And we typically tried to go high end with these things. This is during the economic slowdown of 2012 to 2014. We were finding people that were selling wonderfully unused appliances for a fraction of the cost. So look for bargains and figure out where you can sneak in some fun little pieces of jewelry there that are worth a little bit more, and you'll get to enjoy them that much longer. Demolition, super fun. Save everything. You'll need it. Even if you don't use it, even if it's rotten, hold on to as much as you can, because you're going to need it when it's time to create templates. I'm going to go a little faster here to get through some of these. These are some of the structural repairs, things to consider, like the frame of the trailer itself, the axle, upgrading old cracked plastic to modern Lexan and UV resistant plastics for the exterior. Here's our before and after of our window going in with all new gaskets. Here's our mechanicals hidden under that front sofa that I pointed out earlier, with batteries and an inverter. Example of water pumps, PEX lines. Some people still use copper. A lot of people upgrade to PEX when they're going to go to the trouble of gutting this thing and be inside the walls. At that point, you've got a clean shell, as we do here. And step by step, we began using Reflectix and some other similar kind of foil-faced bubble wrap type materials to create air pockets of insulation so that we could get the highest R value possible within an inch and a half thick wall cavity. And here goes the ceiling back up. And the end caps go on. And eventually you work your way down, all the side skirts are on, and there's our new fresh floor, ready for a floor. But first we painted, masked everything off and used a sprayer. Here's Melissa putting in our cork tiles, which provides all kinds of benefits. It's nostalgic. It has some authenticity to it. It also has some insulation, natural insulation properties. It's also, if you choose a tile format, it's pretty easy to replace one if something becomes damaged. And of course, it's soft underfoot. And typically, the minute you're inside one of these things, you want your shoes off. You want to be comfortable. Here's another example of me contracting out something. In this case, it's the wheel well to a local HVAC company, which was able to do these curves. And then I was able to cut those little tongues along the side to attach to the walls. And then I jumped in earnest on the cabinetry, using some of those original pieces you can see here as templates, using pocket screws to create all of our cabinetry with 1x2 pine, and then wrapping everything in a skin of 1/8-inch plywood. We then ceruse that plywood using a lime oak paste to give it kind of an old-fashioned quality to it. Everything down to the upholstery and the seat cushions have to be thought about in these types of spaces. You can see everything is curved, everything is tapered. So all of that is handmade. Basically, nothing is off the shelf in these things. There's some original lights. You can see an original light sconce there on the left. And here's the template process where you're trying to build a wall and make it out of cardboard. That's easy. It's easy to source and it's inexpensive if you make a mistake. Then you can transfer that shape to the final piece. And there's our final material, the white oak plywood. And here it is with ratchet straps keeping it connected to the channel, the extruded aluminum channel that these bulkhead walls go into. And after that wall is finished, I had a custom piece of stainless steel mounted up and cut to the same angle of the ceiling so that we could mount our little propane fireplace heater. Here comes the kitchen cabinetry, the drawers I sourced, had them built to our specifications just as boxes and then attached our own faces to them. And lo and behold, the oven slips right in. Lots of notes, lots of sketches and measurements along the way. Here's another template of the upper cabinet above the head of our bed. And a couple of the beautiful little lights that go inside. This is a great period shot of an authentic original trailer with the upper locker cabinet, sometimes they're called. They're kind of like the ones above your airplane seats. And they were really kind of diminutive back then. People didn't pack as much into them. And so we added a few dimensions in each direction, a little bit of height, a little bit of depth. I riveted these up myself, cut the faces out, reinforced everything with pop rivets, painted it. And there we had our upper cabinet above the kitchen. It can hold way more than the ones from the 50s. Here's another fun piece that kind of went to fill in a hole that we didn't have any use for. And this is Melissa's nightstand next to the side of the bed. I installed an outlet for charging her laptop and a 12-volt USB port for her to charge an iPad or a phone. That's how it looks from the back. And here's how it looks on the bed platform. That's how it looks once the mattress is installed. Here's the granite kitchen countertops, quartz. We used the thinnest amount of quartz that we could, the thinnest stock so that we had a nice lightweight countertop. Went with some modern finishes. We felt that they blended well with the exterior. And again, because we weren't being slaves to the original factory version because it was in such bad shape when we bought it, we didn't lose any sleep over making these changes. Whereas if we had done this to the prior trailer, it would have been a much more difficult decision for us to make. Here's another example of sending something out for manufacturing at the HVAC place. And they built all these wonderful shade covers for us, just to clean up the appearance a little bit so you're not seeing the mechanics of that. Hardware was going on at this point. I custom built this light switch plate. And there it is next to our closet. And can't stress enough, these situations, these small trailers require you to continue to look for ways to save space and repurpose space and find inefficiencies and capitalize on them and give everything that you can one or more purpose. Put a drawer underneath your seats, put a little cubby where there's a niche between two walls. And in this case, there was some room remaining underneath the countertop left of the oven there. And so that became my nightstand. We're pretty much done at this point. I will have polished it by now, which takes a few weeks. And you can do that to whatever degree you want. You can be kind of casual about it and get kind of a half shine, or you can really go all out and make these things look like mirrors. And here we are hooked up, leaving Chicago for the West Coast. And this is us camping just a few days ago. It's such a rewarding feeling for doing as much of this yourself as you can. And the side benefit is that you know how all this stuff was made. You know the quality that you put into it. If you used marine grade wiring, or you used a nicer quality plywood versus, you know, something flimsy with knots in it, you're aware of all of these systems. And if something goes wrong, you're generally able to either repair it yourself, or you at least know how to start tracing back to the root of the problem. There's some under cabinet warm LED lighting that we put in as many places as possible. It just gives a great ambient glow, and everything's on a dimmer. And here is our last parting shot as we headed through Sedona a few years ago on our way out. There's my email address. If anyone would like to get a hold of me beyond the Q&A, I'm more than happy to answer questions and make as many new friends in this hobby as I'm able. It's always a pleasure. So thank you so much. I think I will stop sharing at this point and go back to...
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi, Brad.
Hi, still together?
Yeah, we're still here, and I'm going to invite Dan onto the group here very quickly. Dan Cutright, if you can activate your video and sound. Let me see if I could get his video started. Hi, Dan.
Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yep, everything's good, and I wanted to thank everybody for... hanging with us an extra bit, a little bit longer. So Dan, can you let everybody know who you are and why you're joining?
Yeah, my name's Dan Cutright. I'm a current member of the board of Napa County Landmarks, along with Sherry Kamamori, who helped organize this presentation by Brad. Brad, thank you. That was a great encapsulation, I think, of history and of travel trailers going back to the 40s. My wife and I have a 1953 Travelease that we fully restored back in 2000. And in fact, when you ran the pictures of the canned hams, the one with the green striping is our trailer.
Oh, how fun. I didn't know that.
Yeah. So that was originally what they called a park model, because besides weekend camping or, you know, just general road camping, a lot of the RV manufacturers would make a version that you could stay in for a while. So it might be suitable for someone who was in the construction industry, was following work or whatever. So our 54 Travelease was what is known as a park model. It was meant to basically get to your destination, set it up and stay for a while. And we found that out the hard way. Shortly after finishing our restoration, pulling it through driving rainstorm in Montana, it took on water up through the vent pipe, the original panel array heater. So it became very clear to me early on that they were not designed for being pulled in inclement weather. The park models to sit down and stay a while. So, but as a result, it has a lot of features that you would expect in a modern, even weekend camper, because they were meant to be much more comfortable to stay in for a period of time. So ours has an opposite side rear door, for example, which makes it kind of unique. And it's only 21 feet overall. So by modern standards, you know, it would be definitely a weekender. And it has a full bath, the original full bath with a metal stall shower. And for those of you in the audience who've ever trailers or are thinking about one universal truth in the vintage trailer world is that if you're married, generally speaking, your wife will insist that we have a bathroom on. And so, and I have to admit, it does make it much more convenient, you know, in terms of middle of the night options. So, anyway, ours was a slightly different version. You don't find as many of them because of the way they were constructed. Airstream, Spartan were all aircraft constructions, so they were riveted over aluminum frame, much more resistant to the elements. Our trailer was basically flooring nails attaching the aluminum siding over a 2-inch hardwood frame. Wow. So taking it halfway apart took me a long time, just because you couldn't back the flooring nails out without prying them up and backing them out. So it's been a rewarding hobby for us as well, and particularly for me as someone who's preservation minded. I see it as mobile preservation, whatever you call it. One last comment I'd make, you'll notice on Brad's trailer, one thing I've learned about Airstream over time is they gradually over the years learned how to stretch aluminum. So when you look at the top corners of the outside, the rounded portion of the end caps, the earlier one, you'll identify the earlier ones by how many panels that were riveted together to form the curve. And as we got into the later 60s, 70s, and 80s, they learned to stretch the aluminum now such that the current version, the modern version, is one solid piece. So a lot of fascinating history from Airstream. They're obviously the iconic brand. One that I think most people identify with when you tell them you have a classic trailer, oftentimes they'll immediately say, oh, it's an Airstream. It's sort of by default, kind of what most people expect. And the reason is more of them survive based on how they're constructed. So I want to thank you, Brad, for doing this. That was really well done. Your trailer's gorgeous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. I had a question for you, Brad. Have you, or I guess either one, but did you ever think about going solar with your restoration?
Great question. Dan, thoughts?
One of the problems with it, if you're a purist, and we use ours sometimes for casual camping. It'll typically be for a weekend, but because of the fact that, you know, it's again, ours isn't really designed to be used, you know, pulled through inclement weather. We tend to use it as fair weather, short-term camping. And usually we're somewhere with hookups. But having said that, there is, current technology where you have a portable suitcase style solar charger that connects directly to the pigtail that goes into your trailer. So it doesn't require any special wiring. And that can help keep your batteries topped off. We were fortunate to camp for 4 days in Yosemite Valley this summer. And we took the old trailer, realizing we weren't gonna have hookups, but we did have the solar panel. We did have water on board. Solar is a very major consideration in RV camping. Many people have solar panels attached to the roof of their particularly modern rigs. But one of the issues for some of us in the vintage trailer world is that having a set of panels permanently affixed to the roof kind of messes with the aesthetics. So there are other options. obviously. The suitcase, portable.
Piggyback on that, air conditioning is the same thing. A lot of people will try and retrofit a window unit into the side of the trailer under a bed or something like that, just to not ruin that overall profile, that that historic look. And right. Dan's right on, spot on. We're shopping for 200 watt solar suitcases right now. In fact, we have a couple of big batteries, and it would be great to be able to not be tethered to every campground as we're going up and down the coast, for example, and be able to stop somewhere and charge once we're there. The other advantage to that portable suitcase version versus a rooftop version is that you can park your trailer in the shade and you have a little bit more of a length to put the solar panels out in the sun. So you're getting the benefit of the cool trailer and the bright sunlight to charge the batteries.
So I have a very quick question before we close out. I noticed in one of the photos, Brad, that you showed, there were propane tanks that looked like they were stainless steel. How do you, is it legal to have propane tanks that are stainless steel, or do you have to clad them in stainless steel? How does that work?
Yeah, everything shiny on our trailer, and I think on most, is actually aluminum. So the skin is aluminum, as well as the tanks. They are made by, I believe, a company called Worthington. I think they're out of Wisconsin, and you can get them in 20 to 40 gallon size and polish them up at the same time you're polishing the trailer.
Great. Well, we're going to quickly close out here. I wanted to thank both of you for being a part of this question and answer, and we always like to forward other questions if they come up to by email to both to you if you'd like to answer them. Thank you for being a part of this today, and we're going to send you, we have a feedback form that I'll paste into the chat box here very quickly. And we'd love to hear what your thoughts were about today's program, but also about what you'd like to see in future programs. So that link that I just am posting publicly here will be where you go to leave feedback about today's program. Thanks again, and if you could please look at the future programs in this series. This is part one of a three-part series, and next week we will be looking at roadside architecture, and week three we'll be looking at a three-hour training session for preservation pro training. So, Chris, did you have anything to add? Muted.
Oh gosh, sorry. I have double mute, as you know. Anyway, thank you, Dan and Brad, for joining us today. And also, I want to encourage everybody to visit californiapreservation.org and donate and join as soon